Good morning, everyone. Thank you for that very generous introduction. This morning, I mean today, no, this webinar, I will be discussing to you the how to navigate phenomenological research and what is phenomenological research is all about. So for the rest of the day, I have several topics to be discussed, starting from the introduction, how to formulate the a phenomenological research question, data gathering techniques, how do you analyze phenomenological data, and then up to how to publish phenomenological data. No? So it's like a one-stop shop webinar, no? From the introduction up to publication. So please bear with me as I will be having 10 PowerPoints, no? For this. And I'll try to make it simple and short but essential and easy to understand as much as possible. So for the first presentation, it will be about the introduction to phenomenological research, understanding lived experiences. No? So most of the time when we talk about phenomenological research, a common study about it is lived experiences. So why is it lived experiences? No? So before we go to that, let's look at the philosophical background of what phenomenological research is and who are the proponents of phenomenological research for us to have a grasp of the beginnings and the essence of this kind of research, no? Because you know this research is different from other research. So in this presentation, first we will be having the definition and the key concepts of phenomenology. Second is the historical background and major contributions. And what is the relevance of phenomenology in contemporary research, you know? This type of research is not specific to a certain discipline, but this kind of research is actually it cuts across, you know, other disciplines. And so why is that so? And why is this important? You know? And why is this a good methodology, you know, a good methodology when you do research? So first, let's deal with the definition and key concepts of phenomenology. So, what is phenomenology all about? So, phenomenological research is a qualitative approach grounded in the philosophical tradition of phenomenology, which aims to explore and describe lived experiences as they are perceived by individuals. So, meaning, phenomenological study is to its focus is to explore and describe lived experiences as perceived by those people who were affected, no? As perceived by those people who really experienced the phenomenon, the individuals themselves. Now, it focuses on understanding the essence of the phenomena through the subjective experiences of people. So, from the subjective perspective of those people who were able to experience the phenomenon, making it distinct from other research methodologies that prioritize objective measurements or external observations. You know, when we do research, sometimes our data is taken from the objective part, no? We as observers, we analyze their behavior, but in phenomenological research or in phenomenology, it's different. No, so we get the subjective perspectives from those people who really experienced what happened. Like for example, if you are going to write a paper about Odette, no, if you're going to write about a paper about Odette, you will interview those people who were there during the storm, no? Those who experienced Odette. No? And you as a researcher, if you did not experience Odette, the data should not be coming from you. It should be from them. No, it's your role is just to tell their stories, no, to retell their stories, no, their experiences of what happened, no, during the typhoon. Now, in phenomenology, there are three central concepts that we have to keep in mind always. Now, first, you have their intentionality. You have life, world, and you have epoch. Now, what are these three central concepts? Now, we will be discussing these three central concepts as we go ahead, no, as we go ahead with this lecture. Now, what is intentionality? Now, phenomenology originated in the early 20th century, you know, primarily to the work of Edmund Husserl. It has defined as the study of structures of consciousness as experienced from the first person point of view. No? So the central concept of phenomenology is intentionality, no, which refers to the notion that consciousness is always about something. Yeah, that consciousness, our consciousness, is always about something. It is directed towards objects, ideas, or experiences. So intentionality underscores the interconnectedness between the individual, we, and the world, and the experience and the phenomenon. So rejecting the dualistic separation of subject and object found in René Descartes' Cartesian philosophy. So here we focus on the connectedness of the people who experience the phenomenon. No? There is this intention of the person to understand what happened during the phenomenon. No? Consciousness is always directed towards something. No? So since those people were able to experience the phenomenon, they are conscious, no, of what happened during that time. So using our senses, we are able to experience from sight, feel, hear, taste. We're able to experience the phenomenon. So they have the intention to understand it based on experience. Another key concept is life world. Life world represents the pre-reflective world, the everyday world in which people lived and experienced their lives. Now, the life world is the background for all experiences and is crucial for understanding how individuals perceive and make sense of their reality. Now, so different people, for example, may have different experience based on a certain phenomenon, because different people may have a different life world. They may have different backgrounds, they have different experiences that somehow shape their perspective today. No? So, like for example, if you're coming from an indigenous people, you have a different life world. If you're coming from a well-off family, you have a different life world. If you're coming from a rural area, from a fishing community, you have a different life world. No? So every day, we have this world where experiences occur. Now, so in phenomenology, it is very important to understand also the life world, how they were able to how their world is about, which is actually the background for all experiences, the background for how they understand a certain experience. Now, because a certain experience could be in front of you, but it could be interpreted in different ways depending on your life world. Okay? Now, another concept in phenomenological research is what we call epoch or bracketing, where researchers suspend their judgments and preconceptions to see the phenomenon from the participant's perspective. So what does this mean? So most of the time as researchers, we already have preconceived biases. We already have bias, no? When we seek data, we already have bias. The moment we see the respondents, we already have bias. We already have those biases. Now, in phenomenological research, there is what we call bracketing. No? This is the point of the research wherein you suspend your judgments, no, and you look at the participants like a blank slate, no, and to look at the phenomenon from their perspective, no, and you know, one hindrance in looking at the phenomenon from their perspective is your bias. No, so you have to write down your bias and you have to be aware of your bias before you proceed, no, with the phenomenological research. And so these are the three, no, initial concepts. Now, epoch allows researchers to describe the essence of the experience without imposing their interpretations or biases. No, so without biases. This alone is already a challenge in phenomenological research. Sometimes we cannot do away with our biases. That's why later, now when we discuss on the steps on how to write or how to collect data in phenomenological research, there is really a certain part wherein you set aside it. You set aside your judgments. There is a way on how to be familiarized with your judgments, with your own biases, and to learn how to set that aside in order to give way for the participants' perspectives. So these are the three concepts. So having intentionality, having life world, and having epoch. Then if you understand all these three concepts, from this discussion onwards, you're able to see now, what really is happening in a phenomenological research. That is when you put yourself and you collect data from the experiences of the people who really experience the phenomenon and with no bias attached from the researcher. So these are the key concepts. Now we go to a little of the historical background of phenomenological research. So you have there, as we have mentioned a while ago, you have Edmund Husserl, is the father of phenomenology. He focused on the essence of experiences. You also have Martin Heidegger. He expanded to include existential questions, being in the world, Dasein. I'll be discussing this in the next slides also in detail. And then you have also Maurice Merleau-Ponty. He emphasized embodied perception. And you have Jean Possart, applied phenomenology to existentialism. Okay. So, who is Edmund Husserl? Now, phenomenology as a philosophical movement began with Edmund Husserl. Now, he is often referred to as the father of phenomenology. Now, Husserl's work, particularly his book, Logical Investigations, laid the foundation of phenomenological inquiry by introducing concepts such as intentionality, epoch, and the phenomenological reduction. Husserl's aim was to return to the things themselves, meaning that he sought to describe experiences as they are perceived without the influence of scientific or theoretical assumptions. That's why Edmund Husserl really wanted that phenomenology, you return to the things themselves. Now, because one pitfall that we have as researchers is that we already have theories in mind. We say, that's structural functionalism working in there. That's Karl Marx conflict theory working in there. But that is not the concept of phenomenology. The concept of phenomenology is to return to the things themselves and investigate there without influence of scientific or theoretical assumptions. So just the pure essence of the experience. That's Husserl's. That's why he is also called as the father of phenomenology. He's the father of phenomenology. Then you have Martin Heidegger. Martin Heidegger expanded phenomenology by incorporating existential and ontological questions. So Heidegger's work, especially Being and Time, emphasized Dasein, being in the world. It's like us being thrown into the world. And we cannot separate ourselves with the world. because we are in the world, no? Our existence is within the world, no? And the idea that human existence is fundamentally intertwined with the world around us, no? So Heidegger's approach shifted phenomenology from a purely descriptive method, which was introduced by Husserl, to one that also considers the meanings and implications of existence, no? Because you just don't experience that, as in sensory experiencing the event or the phenomenon from a sensory level. No, but you experience, you there is something that you experience as you relate also in the world, with the world, no, with the environment, because you are a being in the world. No, you are just not something there that exists with the world, but you are there as somebody connected, no, with that world. Now that's bridging Martin Heidegger's contribution on bridging phenomenology and existentialism. Okay. Now you have Merleau-Ponty's contribution. Merleau-Ponty further developed phenomenology by focusing on the embodied nature of experience. In Phenomenology of Perception, Merleau-Ponty argued that perception is not just a passive reception of stimuli, but an active embodied engagement with the world. No? So, our perception is not just a stimuli, but an embodied engagement, no? Not to us and the world. No, that's why following, no, Martin Heidegger's being in the world, no, that we are not passive reception. We are active. We are not active. We just when the phenomenon came, we just let it pass and as if nothing happened. We're not like that, because when we are able to face with that phenomenon, something changed in us. The experience has somehow taught us. The experience has somehow left a mark, you know, on us. So that's why now that is emphasized, no, in the nature of perception, especially in his work, no, Phenomenology of Perception. No? His work highlighted the role of the body in shaping our experiences and understanding of the world. No? So as we perceive the phenomenon, our understanding of the world also changes. No? So that's according to Merleau-Ponty. No? Another significant contributor of phenomenology is Jean Paul Sartre. Now, Jean Paul Sartre applied phenomenological concepts to existentialist philosophy. Now, Jean Paul Sartre's work on being and nothingness explored the nature of human freedom, consciousness, and the self, asserting that existence precedes essence. No? So, according to Jean Paul Sartre, now, individual freedom and responsibility comes with our being existing. Comes with our existence, no? That's why there's a focus on the lived experiences of individuals in the context of their choices, no? So that's according to Jean Paul Sartre. So these are the people, no, behind phenomenology, no? These are the philosophers who were able to conceive the why phenomenology is very important, no? Phenomenology remains a relevant and widely used methodology in contemporary research, though there are some other kind of researches that they are modifying phenomenological research. They call it by some other names, but if you try to look at it, it's still phenomenology, no? It's still phenomenology. Particularly in the fields of psychology, education, nursing, sociology, no, it emphasizes on understanding lived experiences aligns well with research that seeks to explore complex subjective phenomena that cannot be easily quantified. No? That's why phenomenology is really a qualitative research, because it cannot be quantified. No? Because you are delving into the experiences of those who were able to experience the phenomena. Now, it is more common in these disciplines, no? In psychology, in education, in nursing, and in sociology. No? So, now, but however, it's not limited to those four disciplines. Wherever you are, what discipline you're into, as long as there's this human existence. There's a phenomenon, you have identified a phenomenon that a very important phenomenon that somehow created an impact to this human existence. You can write a phenomenological research. You can write a phenomenological research. Say phenomenological research in psychology, you know, they used to explore mental health issues like depression, anxiety, and trauma. No? So mental health issues, no? Depression. Why were they depressed? They are depressed because of a certain phenomenon. Why is there an anxiety and trauma? No? Because of a certain phenomenon. No? So in psychology, it provides nuanced insights for therapeutic practices. No? So that's in psychology. And there are so many other topics in psychology, especially that psychology deals about behavior and all these stuffs. Another example is phenomenological research and education. Of course, no, understanding students' and teachers' experiences and impact of several educational policies. For example, the impact of matatag curriculum to teachers. The impact of the salary increase to teachers. No? The impact of all those, no? Those experiences, those phenomenon should have left a mark on the people themselves. No? And then there you will ask, no, in a phenomenological way, what are their lived experiences, no, of that? And this is very helpful in creating educational policies in the future, and somehow just to sustainable development. In nursing also, you know, phenomenological research is also very useful. It explores, examples here are, it explores patients' experience of illness, you know, enhancing holistic care practices. The field of nursing, phenomenology is particularly valuable for understanding patients' experiences of illness, treatment, and care. It helps to capture the emotional, psychological, and the existential dimensions of health and illness, offering a more holistic understanding that can improve patient care. Because we need to understand, you know, how their experiences, somehow you can address. You can address the problems that they were facing when they are confronted with that phenomenon. Yeah. Another is in phenomenology, it emphasizes on bracketing and reduction, and this ensures a rigor in phenomenology. No, research findings remain as close as possible to the participants' actual experiences. Now, reducing the risk of researcher bias. Now, because the problem with bias is because of your tone, your biased tone, because of your judgments, you somehow influence, you know, the actual experiences of the participants. Now, that's why in phenomenology, there is a premium, no, to put importance of bracketing, no, to reduce bias. And through this bracketing, we're able to enhance credibility and trustworthiness in research. So I know several studies, you have done such studies on lived experiences. No, but before we conduct the data gathering, sometimes in our mind, we already have biases. Now, if we are not able to address these biases, there is a possibility that it will come out in the analysis. Now, because, you know, our biases, our judgments can somehow come out or can somehow affect our subconscious. Now, whether we like it or not, there's a tone of bias. There's a tone of bias. Now, so that is methodological rigor in phenomenology. Now, to conclude this first presentation, phenomenology provides deep insights into lived experiences. So because of the intentionality, because of the life world, because of the epoch, Now we can get deep insights into the lived experiences of people who experience a certain phenomena. Yeah. And then phenomenological research only is not something that just come out today, but it has a historical root, having it more relevant in modern research. And phenomenology is not a study that is focused on a certain specific discipline. It is a study that cuts across discipline, like psychology, education, nursing, sociology, anthropology, and any social science subjects, and even technical subjects, even in agriculture, even in fishery. As long as there is a human being who is able to experience a certain phenomenon, you can put phenomenological research in there. So that ends our first presentation on the introduction to phenomenological research. If you have questions, just write it down, and I will surely answer them. Thank you, and we will proceed to the next presentation.